worldwide discussion group.
Ooh,
okay, what? We got one. Okay, we'll maybe have more of you later. How many of you are members of any Yahoo discussion group? Okay, so some of you are familiar with it. I'd like to go ahead and just give some background of my interest in pomegranates. This is a picture of Ashley Parfianca, by the way. Some of you were here at the last session there. This is one that was taken at Holtzkill about the time of getting started. I'm a farmer, third generation farmer. I have an avid interest in hobby plants too. I have 25 varieties of bananas and 34 varieties of papaya and a lot of white sapote and things like that. I'm a collector. I didn't inherit the farm. I was in lending. I wanted to get back. Even when I bought a large city yard, that's not enough. I didn't like the neighbor 5 or 10 feet away from me. I have 47 acres in my farm. You can see that orchard there, the chestnut orchard, with a corner cut off. It extends 3,000 feet off to the east from there. The Sacramento River to the west of me, there is over a mile wide. We have abundant water, very occasionally way too much water. Most of my farm are below sea level, and our levees can fail from flood. So the house that I live in, they're near a pool. It was actually flooded in 70 when we went to the countertops for several months. It's not like the water raises and it goes away when it recedes. We need to repair the levee and pump for many months to get the water out. So I have alfalfa off the bees. I don't have a laser pointer or anything, but this is an area where I can test. This is a chestnut orchard here. I have a chestnut orchard over here. Now, how do I operate this here? So, here's my home here. Some of my exotics have grown around my home here. Chestnuts are something I direct market, and I like it because I can market direct to consumers and be successful with that. Head up the middleman. I had some test plots of different types of chestnuts in this area here, and I had over 50 varieties of chestnuts at one time, and I'm down maybe 10 or 15 now, I don't know, but it's hard to do something commercially with that many varieties. You would take hours to explain to a consumer the differences of the different varieties, but I decided the ones I wanted to grow, and I started to get an interest in pomegranates, and I ended up planting this area here. People think that, 47 acres, you can plant it much more. Well, it's commercial. Drive alfalfa out, standing out in an area like this. I'm in an area with natural gas wells. I don't own the mineral rights, unfortunately. I would have maybe greenhouses or something like that, but there's a natural gas well that cuts up the disruption to my farm. There's a couple of gas wells on my property. But this is alfalfa out here. So this is the area where I decided to allocate pomegranates, but even now I don't have enough room. I need more room. I think I have a few more trees on the end of each row over here, but I need to park equipment somewhere. I have a drainage ditch here. We have drainage ditches because we have a high water table. We need to drain the water, so I have my own confines too. Plus, people think, oh, it's so nice to have a big yard. I'm sure I have more weeds than most anybody. There might be a few people with farmers here, but there's a lot of weeds that come with that, too. That gives you an idea where I'm from. And I'm in the Sacramento San Joaquin Delta. I'm about 35 miles south of Sacramento. This is my pomegranate orchard. Lose track here. I think it was planted in the spring of 2008 now. So this is 3.5 years old. I tried to keep, one thing I ended up doing a test plot with Jeff Foss. He wanted somebody to do a trial, and so I thought that would be cool to do. But one thing I found, when you, here's number two is Parfianca. Well, you walk through the orchard, are my Parfianca ripe or yet? Well, it's kind of hard to tell, but is this Parfianca? I think I can go back to my map. No, you need to walk out there with the map. and when I harvest, so just imagine you gotta go from here to here to here. I color coded it besides numbers so I can make go through, but this is a scientifically test or we can evaluate them later on. So I have this is the row here. They're 12 feet apart and they're 16 feet apart between the rows. So I drive down the middle here and I just pick one right in at a time. And maybe the last 2 years have been cool, so not like a good year, but eventually I'm going to be bringing fruit to Wolfskill. Now, Jeff didn't mention, but he has two trees of each variety, except for that one that he showed last time, and only had one remaining tree. So he doesn't have enough to actually evaluate the fruit, but eventually we'll evaluate the fruit. I've come to some conclusions already, like Sympepi, he mentioned the soft seed of one, is very low vigor. But this gives you an idea. Now, on the end, my test plot is from here to here. On the ends, I have other trees, and some of that is intentional so that, maybe Ripper at the end of the row gets plugged up. Don't want to have a tree on an important tree on the end, and so we have to there. So that gives you an idea of what my test plot is. And I end up trying to squeeze in more varieties in there, and I still don't have enough room. I have about 50 varieties now, and I'm going to interplant some here, I think, just to evaluate them, and some will get yanked out later, so they'll be 6 feet apart there. And I might end up yanking out some heavy because it's too low a figure. My origins of interest in pomegranates, I'm not sure. Like Richard mentioned, Barbara Berry written an article, and I read it, and it sounded pretty fascinating to me. I didn't realize there were all these varieties of pomegranates, and never even remembered hearing of Turkmenistan before. And started reading about that. I ended up getting Pomegranate Roads, the book that Barbara published there. I've got it here. On there. How many of you have read Pomegranate Roads? If you have any interest in pomegranate, I highly recommend you read that. I'm not a book reader, but I could not put that down. To me, it was like an Indiana Jones of pomegranate. I mean, it was exciting. Like, I can still, it's been 4 years.
$5.
Going up on a ridge of a mountain and trying to turn a truck on the precipice of a mountain and climbing down cliffs is pretty exciting. It's great. It's something that I'd like to do, I think. I was in some other Yahoo groups and someone told me, hey, another friend of mine, a chestnut friend of mine, actually, hey, there's other Yahoo discussion group called Rare Fruit, mostly focused on tropical and subtropical fruit. There had been some discussion going on there with some pomegranate with Ariel Shai of Israel. He was one that was promoting it. That group didn't really like talking about pomegranates too much because we've got people from Hawaii and Central America and so forth. And they're there again focusing on tropical. I went to a tasting and I decided I had already developed some email communications with different people, Richard, Ashton, he sent me some seeds of some varieties. I decided to start a discussion group for pomegranates because some of the people that they got turned off, too much focus on pomegranate. And I'm a member of forums as well as Yahoo groups and one Google group. And I actually was a proponent of forums being better because you can have more content there, you can organize it. But I was an auditor for many years, and I was trying to be objective about it, and I saw the participation being much greater in Yahoo groups than either Google groups or in forums. I myself am a member of a banana forum, bananas.org, but I don't think of even going back there sometimes for a week or two or maybe more, but if an email lands in my inbox, which is the typical delivery means of a message in a Yahoo group, hey, pomegranates, and I'll reply to it. And it's much more interactive, and so I went with it that way. I'm going to, you know, just mention, here's Dr. Levin here, and this was a photo taken, I believe this was for the 2007 or 2008 Pomegranate Tasting, is when it was there. Ariel, he's kind of a crazy and radical guy, and very intense there. The language, you know, is pretty strong, but it's just more of a cultural difference. He's not a mean guy, or anything. I know him pretty well. But he wanted us, oh, here, it was the 2007 tasting there. He put this poster up. He visited Dr. Levin. He's taken on some agricultural tours around Israel. Dr. Levin is here in Tel Aviv now. And he asked me, oh, can you take some of these pictures and put them out in Wolfskill so we can send them back to Dr. Levin? So I did this. So here's the website address for the Yahoo discussion group. To join it, you go there and join. It's a long address to type. You go into even Google and just type Palm Worldwide. It'll come up as the first hit there. It'll maybe come up. So that's easier than writing all of that. There is searching Palm Worldwide. Again, I created that I was having some email discussions with people, but then also I have 20,000 emails in my inbox right now. I'm not very good at sorting through that sometimes there, but if it's in a, if all my pomegranate stuff is in one group there, I can find things easier. We can store photos there. We have links to the other sites there. So I want to find more people to discuss pomegranate with people around the world because, until 5 years ago, I just knew wonderful. I didn't know anything other than wonderful. And, we don't really have that long a history of experience with pomegranates here compared to the centuries or thousands of years of pomegranates in other parts of the world. So it started beginning of this year with 146 members. We're up to 183 members. The group isn't for everybody. I mentioned Ariel, I'll just be open. If you join this group, realize you're interacting with people with different cultures. Some people think that Ariel is rude, and that I know he's not. I know him very well, better than I've had many contacts with him over the year. I visited Israel on a pilgrimage once there, and people were pushing and shoving and all that, and I asked about it, and they said, oh, to survive in Israel, you need to be a prickly pear. And that's the way they got bombs coming at them from all sides and all that. So it's just a way that they're accustomed to interacting with them. But also, he says, oh, you need to try this. No, don't you realize this? Well, he's not meaning to be offensive. That's the way he talks. So on the other hand, I've worked with people in my prior profession in a different culture where they couldn't tell me if they disagreed with me. That was more dangerous. I think that if I was driving a car but they're in the passenger, I was driving the wrong way on a one-way street, they might not tell me to hurt my feelings. Go ahead, hurt my feelings. I remember from my group posted the other day in response to the problem interaction we had. Oh, it's just a little salt. We need some salt. Don't worry about it. If it's a little too salty, don't let it bother you. The way that they spoke. And I've been to Italy, and people are yelling at one another there, but he's friends with them. It's just the way they talk. So we lost two members the other day, but we've already gained more members than that. The guy from Brazil wasn't too happy about something, and the guy from Tennessee agreed with him and left too. And that's fine. So we started out with just 34 members and by the end of 2007. We started in October 2007. So to give you an idea of what it looked like, we ended up with an average of 38 messages so far this year per month. We have members from the United States, a lot of different states. Earlier there was mentioned by Richard Salagaski growing in Tennessee. I know a guy growing in Pennsylvania, which I was pretty impressed. With that too, it gets real cold there. But we have Florida, Texas, Arizona. I would say that out of 183 members, maybe 50 of them are from California, so it's not a California-dominated Peru. I put all the eyes here together. I was thinking about it. It's just coincidence. They're from Israel, India, Italy, Iran, Australia, Philippine Island. I remember we had Egypt. We had a guy from Egypt posting this morning. I lived before I came here. Australia, I mentioned. We have others I know there. And some people don't post very much. I had a guy post the other day. Oh, I've been a lurker here for 2 years, and I read all the messages. I just don't contribute. It'd be good if people do contribute their own experiences. You know, some of the ideas here, I want to get an idea of my time here, because I can talk for a long time. I think that, you know, some of the interesting topics that, you know, I wouldn't even thought about before trying or so forth, you know, different propagation methods. At the last session, someone asked Jeff Moorfelder about parafilms on cuttings, and one of the members does that. And instead of misting, I mean, using misting in propagation, where you're doing that to reduce moisture loss, well, he wraps, he decides where the soil line is going to be, and he wraps the top there and sticks it in the ground. And there's not much moisture loss then, and he had a high success rate with that. You know, fortunately, one of our members passed away this last year, had an aneurysm from Mississippi, and he suddenly died. And he had this idea of having perlite, some of the maybe more natural type product, I can't remember, vitamin D1 and so forth, in a liquid, it's sort of a hydroponic solution with fish aquarium bubblers in it and all that, and he bubbled up and he had really fast root growth in that. So the, you had nutrients, a lot of air, getting new air all the time, and he had whatever he thought of that. It was pretty interesting what I had. Another guy, he puts a 2 liter soda bottle, he cuts the bottom off and he sticks it over the cutting, and oh, he unscrews the cap. If it's too humid in there, he leaves the cap off. So there's different, you know, tricks there, things that we can, you know, think about. You know, Jeff mentioned your use of bottom heat there. And I'm not sure if you were, some of you weren't at the last sessions, but using bottom heat below the cuttings to help stimulate faster root growth. There's one thing, the tops start showing leaves usually well before we have roots. And so you're trying to increase you know, the activity going on the soil level before the top to keep up. I mean, I actually had another, I'm not sure if she's a member of this group or not, another group. I visited her once. She had pomegranates in sand for over one whole year when I visited her, and there were green, there were small, tiny twig type cuttings, pulled it up, still no roots on it. So she was keeping it, these cuttings alive, but not the bottom heat, and so she was in the cool area not getting any growth. Racking experience. You know, a lot of us, not bad mouthing Dave Wilson at all, but you know, a lot of advocation has been made of three holes, or three trees in a hole. So that sells them more trees than there. You know, certainly, you know, they have some multi-grafted trees too, and they charge more for that. That's another way to do it, but then you can't select what varieties you're getting. But I, you know, did some grafting. I heard some grafting, and I've actually been successful with grafting. You know, and I thought, oh, this might be, what am I going to market myself, sell some multi-grafted trees for the backyard grower. I'm not sure yet what the issue is, but I did have one angel red that I grafted three different varieties on, and all of those died after they grew really well for 1 year. The following year, I had one limb die, and then later on in the year, the other two limbs died. I have no idea what, it might be a compatibility issue, different seed types. In Chestnuts, I know my own experience, big, big problem with compatibility. And white sequoia, so it might be something maybe be selective on the rootstock I'm using. 3 minutes for what?
It's 12:30.
That's 12:30. It says 12:30 on here.
Oh, they told me a half an hour.
That's why. I apologize.
They go, go, go.
I thought this was really going really fast. Okay, thank God.
So, another people, so I know that Ariel in Israel, he had tried grafting, so he tried grafting, and so some of us have been trying that, and for some things, I know that I got fruit, I got flowers the first year on grafts, and fruit the second year, so it's faster, too. If you already can buy an established plant, that's one way of getting a faster plant. Flower types, now if you say male versus female, and I don't think that, I'm going to say male versus complete. Those the flower being called females are complete flowers. They have stamens on them as well. But I didn't really notice that. You know, Richard mentioned it, Jeff was talking about it, showed some photos of that there. Ariel is very intense about it. Ariel, you can get from Israel. He made a lot of discussion of this and picking off the male flowers right away, so more energy goes into the complete flowers, so the, you know, larger fruit. In Israel, one thing I found out that they don't have that as a category, size. You know, I guess they make big tanks, they want big pomegranates too. They want, you know, like 2 kilos. You know, we want, you know, big fruits. They want, no, oh, the market, you know. Gosh, you know, that's too big. You know, as you get a 25-pound turkey for Thanksgiving, that's pretty big. If we have a 50-pound turkey, you know, I don't think so. No, I mean, how big do you really need? You know, I know, Palm Wonderful, most of the fruits we see in the markets are about a pound. I saw some the other day, a pound, 12 ounce. But, you know, how big do you want? I know in pitaya, the discussion has been a really large fruit ends up being a very expensive fruit, and then you can't sell it as well. Well, the same thing with pomegranates, too, but it depends on what your market is commanding, though. For a homeowner, I don't think size is too important. You know, half a pound is fine. That's enough if you want to have something else. I have Sacchedese, or however you pronounce them. Edgar came and visited there. He was really impressed with the size. It was 2.12 pounds, and he was going to balance it on Pat's head, and it fell off and broke, and that was my largest fruit. It's a hard-seeded type, so I wasn't too upset either. But, you know, that's another, you know, but we're trying to thin, and, Richard mentioned earlier today, and this is something I'll be posting about in the group here, where we share ideas, or just removing all the flowers as they come on later on in the year once you've got your main crop set there. I reduce fruit, but yeah, it's wasteful. You know, I don't think about things like that. And also cutting off the sucker early in the year. I honestly leave most of mine, or a lot of them there during the year because I figure I might use it for propagation later on. But it's when you're balancing two different projects there. You know, uniformity of seedlings. Dr. Levin has written about that in Pomegranate Rose there and talked about how in some areas where that's a common means of propagation. You know, most of the things that we grow, that's not an acceptable means of propagation. It ends up with something quite a bit different. Richard gave me the seeds of Radula and Ganesh and Molar before, and I've grown those there. I don't have the original to compare them to. There, some of those are at Wolfskill now, and I will compare them to them. But the fruits fit. Fruits and plants fit the description of the plant, so it seems, you know, an acceptable way. I got out of the seed business. Because I started this group, everyone would ask me, "Oh, you have all these varieties. Can I get seeds from you?" I don't have time for that. I don't get enough. Big as it is, and knowing seeds to the Philippines and Africa and different places like that. But that's one way it's easier to get seeds. I got seeds of Cunica, Protocunica, and I'm not positive that it's, I haven't got fruit off of it yet, but you know, that came from Hawaii. Well, I certainly couldn't get fruit sent to me from Hawaii very well, or cuttings rather. And so it's easier just to get seeds sometime we can go with that. I you know, through these different people mentioned, and I hear that there's a black pomegranate in Uzbekistan. And so I start searching, that gives me a, you know, it's a holy grail out there for me. I'm a sucker maybe for having started this group, because people put ideas out there, and I follow all of these different leads. So, and it benefits everybody from this. But I just thought, how can I find out Uzbekistan? I've never even heard of the country before. Yeah, I could get someone, Peace Corps or something like that. I researched that stuff, and I ended up deciding I'm going to try a tour company, because they have outsiders coming in. And I found some sucker on the other end there. He goes, yes, this, I apologize up front, this is an interesting request, I realize, but I wonder if you could help me. Yes, this is an interesting question, but I like your idea and I will help you. So he ended up, and I have some photos here later, he sent me seeds. I didn't import any illegally. He flew to New York, and he knows them to me from New York, so, along with the CD with pictures. Pruning methods, Richard mentioned this also earlier here, you know, not just, you know, three or four stems versus one stem. You know, I've seen pictures of Israel where they've got V-shaped and on wires, and I thought, this is something I might try. I don't really want to spend the money on a trellis system, but I'm in an area that's windy in the afternoon with a lot of scarred fruit in. Not only to support the branches when they get heavy, but tie the branches to prevent them moving from the wind. And so that's something, you know, that I thought was quite valuable that I, again, wouldn't have learned if it wasn't for this group. Your methods to control diseases. You know, India, and I want to caution people from bringing cuttings into the United States illegally, because there's a lot of diseases out there that we haven't seen in California and pomegranate. In India, there's, I read where maybe 40% of the orchard had been pulled out due to, I'm not sure if it was a virus, I believe it was a virus disease there. We don't want that brought here. And so, but there's other, you know, and I'm not sure what all the diseases are that they had in their pumps. The other day, spraying, it was a blight-type disease. They were spraying with streptomycin, their trees there, trying to control this. There's been some disease problems in Texas. Some varieties are more susceptible than others, and there's been some people experimenting with different sprays there. Sunburn, you know, experience it. You know, Ariel, again, I'll mention it because he posts a lot there. He may post six messages yesterday or whatever. You know, bagging fruit. That's an easy way to keep bugs off of the fruit. Not an easy way. That's a way to keep the bugs off of the fruit. But for a homeowner, if you got 50 fruits, that's not a big deal to do. It also shades the fruit from getting sunburned. Richard mentioned the surround earlier. I was checking in to my supplier, my farm supplier. They didn't carry surround any longer. Pure shade. It's kind of a glorified product, but the same thing. I think it's maybe got a spreader on it that maybe makes it stick on longer. But that's used commercially. I've seen walnut orchards in California, especially the outside rows, anyway, sprayed all the way around to eliminate or reduce sunburn, and for pomegranates it's used too. In parts of California, it may be Arizona where the sun is, in Texas where the sun is really helpful. I don't know if it's able to have the same beneficial side effect of insect control as surround or not. I think so. It's calcium carbonate in it and something else, I forget. But, that's two methods. Now, one thing on the pure shade too that I posted on the group is I thought, okay, we'll decrease photosynthesis. Richard mentioned that, oh, you thought maybe it might make the fruit less dark, but it made it darker. The pure shade distributor or rep for California told me that when the leaf temperature gets over think he said 90 degrees. Photosynthesis, we're filtering out some of the light. You're actually getting more photosynthesis over the day because you're keeping the temperature of the leaf down. Now, I don't know. I haven't seen the scientific research to prove that, and he's trying to sell a product. It sounded kind of reasonable. You know, talking about varietal performance in different climates here, I know with Edgar, when he came to my place, you know, my Eversweet was quite a bit different than his Eversweet. The fruit here in Arizona is quite different. We talked about fruit, and the people in Texas said, oh, this was terrible. It was very good here. And so you find out, you can't just make a recommendation based. So if you're a grower from Texas, searching online, trying to find information about pomegranates, you're never going to come across, you know, California information, which might not be very useful to you. So it's good to have the group communicate different experiences. Methods to enjoy pomegranate. As mentioned, I don't have a photo, so I was just trying to market this. I have a website, and I'll just mention it. If you want to see how this gadget works, it's an arrow removal tool. The acronym of ART, A-R-T, for that product. And I imported, 200 or 300 of them from Israel. I just decided to search on eBay to see if I could find a pomegranate machine or something on there. And I came across this, and I bought a couple from an eBay seller from Israel. And then I thought, this is pretty cool. And some other people tried it. Most people liked it. I wouldn't say it's great. It's pretty good. It's very inexpensive. I decided to import some. But, you know, Richard was familiar with the spoon method, but someone mentioned that. I had never heard about that. Both the spoon method and the ART are both demonstrated on one of my websites, and it's purelypons.com. P-U-R-E-L-Y, Pons, P-O-N-S.com. I have a little video of both methods there. And I'll say that arrow removal tool was demonstrated with a fruit that was overripe, so it didn't work as well as that normally will work. I found out about the spoon method from the Yahoo group, so that's another thing we share that. But one thing I found with both of those methods is the fruit isn't quite ripe. Neither one works as well. The arrows stick tighter to the pit until they're ripe. When they're getting ready to burst apart, they come out easier. When they're not mature, they're not ready to burst apart yet. So a lot of the fruits that we sometimes find in the store, especially early in the year, aren't quite ripe. A lot of people use pomegranates for juice. I hear of people doing a lot of juice blends. One of our group members said every day he's drinking pomegranate orange juice, and he freezes it up. I think he's sold for life on that. And so he talks about, there's a citrus press that, you know, people use. I think that seems to impart some more bitterness in the juice when I've tried it, so I prefer not to do it. Another thing I've done is remove all the arrows. I'll run it in a blender, just pulsing it some, and then run it through a sieve, and that works pretty well. Here is, you've heard Dr. Levin's name mentioned, you know, a few times, but it's not mentioned. Here's Ariel, Jewish, obviously, and visiting Dr. Levin. Dr. Levin is holding a black pomegranate in here. Everyone seems to want a black pomegranate. They're not that good of a fruit one, but they're attractive. And I'm growing a seedling of this particular fruit here. Now this year, Ariel got one of these fruits from this tree. Same tree that this gave him, is 500 grams, so over a pound. So he's pretty good. He did thin fruits, but also he thought the weather was better in bagging them. He took better care of it. So he thought the fruit quality was really good. He takes a lot of time on it. He counts all the arrows from the fruit, and And last year we had 300 arrows maybe for the fruit, and this was 600 arrows in this year's fruit or whatever. That's a lot of counting. I don't know, you must be the count the arrows for all my different fruits. No, I'm not saying you do it. And then everyone gives, yes, you must do it. No, I must. Well, it goes back and forth. We did a chat video session one time while driving down I-5 over the left. Up there with him with a friend from Puerto Rico. It's kind of interesting hearing his voice for the first time. But Dr. Levin lives in a rather austere environment there. He's in a very small apartment. They have shirts on here. Ariel told me that they had their shirts off most of the time because it was like an oven and enough. He did not have the money for air conditioning. Running it very much anyway. Here's a listing of varieties from Wolfskill here that Ariel speaks English and Hebrew. Dr. Levin speaks some Russian and Russian. A little bit of Latin. They actually communicate some of Latin. I'm not sure, Richard, do you realize that during some of the tours that Ariel took Dr. Levin on, Dr. Levin worked with hunters of a variety of future bees, too. Mm-hmm. And because they went on, these familiar started talking about these and all these are good. And so I don't know to what extent there, but it sounded like he had a very large collection of future bees. But he was making some corrections on some spelling here and writing some things. I never really got all of this back here, but he's going through a list there. In the last session here, Marta was here. She heard me talk before. She didn't want to talk anymore. She wanted to learn about Kaya, actually. But she's fluent in Russian. And she asked me more about Serenevi. I like Serenevi. It's a good pomegranate. Just at medium to large. I think it's large to very large. And one thing I found, it's a later season, though. It's not a ripen for me this year. It's not warm enough. But what the history of this? I don't know. But if you want, you can write Dr. Levin or you can call him. I have his phone number and his email address. And they think, I talked to him last night. And he told me, and she goes on as part of the soft seed breeding project began in 1967 and all this. And I found out more about it and what year he named it and all that. So it's pretty interesting to have this contact. Many of you know that we were trying to get Dr. Levin here. His health just isn't good enough. His wife had traveled to Russia not too long ago there and just kind of test her out on that. It was a hard trip. And just, risking her health to try to get this long of a trip. But he knows about me. Now, I did send seeds to Ariel. Got an import permit for seeds, and so I sent him some Punica protopunica seeds there, and Dr. Levin is growing a seedling of that when I last heard him, when he decided to get that. He wrote about it, but never saw it. Now, I mentioned earlier about Uzbekistan there. I've never seen a fruit opened up like this, and this is the way, and I said, wow, this is amazing. Oh, thank you. I'll tell my father he did that. He's very good at that. He'll be glad to hear that you're, appreciating that. So this is the black pomegranate in Uzbekistan. Not very black, though. This is what my quest was for there. I got three different varieties. I got Nafish or something like that, and Camel Tooth. And I don't know, this guy took pictures on the scale and all that. I think Camel Tooth must be a big arrow, I'm hoping. Maybe the size of a camel's tooth. Probably not. Find out when I get fruit, maybe next year. Okay, here's some seedlings I have, Punica, Protopunica. Now, Richard mentioned Radula earlier. This is a seedling of mine. It has lots of flowers on it right now. I don't pick any flowers. I'd be picking flowers off constantly on that. It'll have flowers. Well, in many environments, it would be evergreen. And tournament is a good fruit. I think it, for some climates. Now, David Silverstein told me once that it didn't sweeten up very well for him. It wasn't warm enough in San Diego to get good sweet fruit. So I'm not sure what the ideal climate is. It needs good, but I think in a tropical climate or a zone 10, it'd be everything. Last year, this particular plant, it had one fruit, one leaf rather, that stayed on all year round. Or maybe it dropped off after new leaves started coming out. And we got that to 25 degrees. So it's a last to lose leaves, the Bodecki and Ganesh, which was one of its parents. I'm not sure it's either maternal or paternal parent. But it's a pretty plant, lots of flowers, and the fruits aren't very large, but they're good quality. I want to talk about the group, operation of the group, some more. You know, a lot of you aren't members of the group, a Yahoo group, you didn't join. The way I put it is everyone that joins, unless I already know them, they're subject to moderation. Because I've been members of groups with so much spam, this group, the only spam message this group has had is from me, because I had a Trojan virus on my computer, my Yahoo pastor got stolen, and one message got posted to the group, so I apologize to the group. So the only person that's not, automatically subject to moderation is me or people I know. So, but you did the post to the group, you send an email to online@yahoogroups.com, you gotta be a member. Now, for the message to come to you, you can have each time a person posts a message, it gets delivered to your inbox, or you can, I can't handle six messages a day, or some two messages, 10 messages someday. I don't want all that. It gets too long. You get a daily digest where it's just one message a day. I know another very active group I mentioned earlier, Rare Fruit, they'll maybe get two daily digests a day because they're just, it's already 20 messages. So, or you can, I don't want any emails. I'll just go visit when I want, and you just go to the group and you read the messages. You don't even need to be a member of the group to read the messages, though, but I could control that if I wanted, but no, I want it to be open. You can't view the photos if you're not a member, and I can't control that. There's no settings to change that. I can have it set to where non-members can view links, I think. We have a list of links there, which is a good, useful set of resources there. So, I don't think it's too much. Now, myself, I have several email addresses, but primarily two. My groups all go to harveycorea@yahoo.com. If I don't have time for, group messages, I don't go to my Yahoo account. So unfortunately, sometimes someone will send me a really important message to that account. Oh, I don't need it, so I have time. But my other accounts for important business matters, put in another one. But I don't find that many messages, even 10 a day to be a problem. So again, here's Parfianca. Here's another fruit. Another one. Are there any questions?
What's your favorite one that you're drawing right now?
I'll say dessert is my favorite. I mentioned there are different taste preferences, we have. Edgar here, he likes sweet, soft, seeded. I know that. Jeff, I know he likes sweet tart. And he doesn't care for the soft too much there. I pretty much like all of them. Now, the only one I don't like, Jeff mentioned Hokka Pecan Banana. That's just tart. I don't taste anything besides tart. I can't taste anything. If I had a miracle fruit berry to try, maybe I would really enjoy that fruit a whole lot more. But like Jeff always has that as the last fruit at his tasting. I haven't bothered to taste the last couple years. I know I don't like that at all. So I wouldn't bother. But I enjoy it. But I was just saying, desserting I like because it's very saucy and it's sweet.
And it's got some tartness to it.
What was it?
Dessert-y.
Dessert-y?
Yeah, D-Z-E-R-T-N-Y-I, but dessert in Russian. So now, and Sarah Nevy, I had mentioned there earlier as being a large, a very large food. I sell chestnuts online. This customer, a big customer of mine in New York, he's a fruitarian. Now he likes to eat 10 pomegranates a day. I sent him a variety box. Sarah Nevy, I can see you selling these for $10 a piece. They're great. You know, I want to buy 600 of them next year. No, you can't. I can't sell them. Where can I buy them? Nowhere. Nobody can. Commercially. But then the next 2 years, my fruit hasn't ripened. So, and you know, warm weather. So there's a limitation. This way.
I have a question.
Oh, it needs to be under here.
What do you recommend for coastal California, the mild summer climates?
Well, I would look, that's been talked about later. Edgar's going to talk on the chatter variety, and I would listen to Edgar's talk on that because John Chatter, am I saying that right? Chatter or Chater?
Chater.
I always forget which word is wrong right there. John Chater's from Camarillo, so we're trying to find ones that grew well in his climate. I'm kind of surprised that Purple Heart, which Dave Wilson marked as sharp velvet, and by the way, I should have mentioned that, I have some synonyms listed in the group where we shared that there. Garnet Sash, we thought was elf, and then became Farbianca, and no, the guy that came up with that idea of switching what variety they were going to sell is Garnet Sash. No longer with the company there, they admit the CEO that we know we never made that switch. But that Purple Heart is unlike any of the other Chater varieties. I thought that it's got more tartness than any of the other ones he has. So I was listening to Edgar's talk on that because those are some good ones there, I think, for the summer area. Now you can see someone else in front of you left. Yes, go.
I'm cutting the pomegranates and making them fold out like that. You just cut it down the side?
Yeah, well, you cut the top off. I know it doesn't look like they cut the top off as much as this, but maybe a little bit less than that. But you want to expose a little bit. And you see these segment lines here, then. Mm-hmm. And you cut down there. And I haven't done that myself yet. I
want to try that.
I need to try that myself there. I don't usually have. But they. See, there, they put that in the middle of the table then, and that's kind of a fun way to do it. But now I know one of these Egyptian co-workers, my wife, said, oh, they like putting salt on it, too. I don't know. Yeah, I don't need salt. I don't know. There's a lot of different customs there. I was just taking pictures of the sample fruit at one time, and this is one. But yeah, this year I haven't done it myself there, but it seems to be quite a talent that this guy had, because I had 3 on the photos of them.
So do you start with the flower side?
This is the flower side up here on this side. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember now, I do it kind of automatically, and I don't think about the flower. One thing I want to mention now, and I forgot, I had it listed at the top of the discussion. One thing that we got discussing and backing up on different types of topics. Most of us homeowners, we don't spray much and all that, and even my small farm, they're meeting with a lot of insects in the calyx. Well, I've shipped some fruits and I can't insect. It's illegal for me to ship a earwig to New York or something like that, even though it's not very harmful. It's just scary as a homeowner, maybe. But there's spiders in there and things like that. We talked, about cutting calyxes off then. Some varieties really, Sarah Nevy is one. They're tight. You can't get that. You need to cut it. So we have experimented with that some, and there's been some success with that there, cutting them off. Not completely off, but now like Ariel, he cut it completely off, the fruit split. That was kind of a knot that was holding the fruit together, it seems. So some interesting things like that. I see someone else had a question. Dingello?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, that's where some of the soft-seeded azadi is one. It's a soft-seeded sweet type. We put it in spinach salad and things like that. It's really good. There, those soft seating types, it's nice to mix in with other things. You don't want to be spinning out seats. I mean, I swallow them anyway, but a lot of people don't want to bother with the hard seat. Yes?
Can you put on the surround for the reduced sunburn? Can you put it on to from the fruit, the leaves, and
the whole plant?
Even the trunks.
Well, not much actually gets to that. It's not that heavy effect. It's not even a complete. When I put on, and I used Pure Shade, it was splattered somewhat or whatever it was. But it covers everything. I mean, put it on with a orchard sprayer. And it is, I'd say that Ultra Shade, Pure Shade rather, has an organic form and a non-organic form. But it just covers everything. Because the Pure Shade will reduce the sunburn of the fruit, but also being on the leaves reduces the stress on the leaves too. That reduces the temperature of the leaves and makes photosynthesis.
Yeah.
Okay, 2 minutes early. I think we're done. Okay, thanks a lot.